When you know that you are queer, but your favorite drink is beer, that's gayish. You can bottom without stopping, but you can't stand going shopping, that's gayish. Oh, gayish, you're probably gayish. Well, life's just too short for narrow stereotypes, so it's gayish. We're also gayish. It's gayish with Mike and Kyle.
Hello, everyone in the podcast universe. This is Gayish,
the podcast that's been inside of you this whole time.
But not for too many hours.
It depends on what you're into.
Okay, great. I'm Mike Johnson.
I'm Kyle Getz.
And we're here to bridge the gap between sexuality and actuality. And today...
today, we're going to talk about that bitch.
We're going to talk about Dolly Parton.
Dolly Parton, yeah.
And not mention her giant boobs.
Good
even
luck.
Even once.
Us. Even this time. Pardon me. I don't really care about Dolly Parton.
Yeah, yeah. Not to be confused with Dolly the Sheep.
But was named after her.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Did I just ruin a segment? Great.
One segment down. No, that wasn't a segment. I did learn about that from her podcast. That's ruining a segment a little bit. But
okay.
Anyway.
Great. But first?
But first. I have listener feedback to share with you.
Okay.
You've already seen this, but...
Oh, is this like corrections?
I mean, it's correcting you as a person.
Okay, great. Here we go. I love it. What's the worst that could happen?
They sent this. Well, you know this. They sent this just to me, but I shared it with you. Someone said, I'll just take a portion of it. It's like, blah, blah, blah. Y'all are awesome. And then if anyone, parentheses, kids out there who heard Mike say, quote, I find it uncomfortable, very much a turnoff. What is wrong with you? That was in reference to fabric fetish.
Mm-hmm. No. It was in response to fabric on my dick.
Right, yeah.
Okay.
Fabric. General fabric commentary. Continuing the email. Don't be ashamed. There's nothing wrong with you. Enjoy being turned on and masturbating with fabric. That is from Jensen.
Yep.
Actually,
first of all, if anybody actually like felt that I was shaming them, I apologize for that. That's not cool.
I will say, oh, you were about to keep going.
Oh, I have a little bit of a hard time with this because, like, we've talked about this in our Facebook Messenger and I don't think we've talked about it in person yet. But
here we go.
Like, I say that to people who like grape soda. Like, what is wrong with you? And it's not meant to like actually shame the fact that like drink grape soda, love it. I'm glad that it makes you happy. I support your right to drink grape soda.
I
don't even really. It's just an expression that I use sometimes to mean like that is not for me. I don't get it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And, but if that turns into actual shame, that sucks.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Well, I support what we want to do is keep expressing how we feel about things. And for example, I find it uncomfortable. Like you should say that. Well, I mean, you did. And you should say that if you feel uncomfortable about a fetish.
Sure.
I don't understand it. But at the same time, that's something I've learned from this podcast is like, well, that doesn't mean that anyone else is bad for doing it. And hopefully we don't imply that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You like rosé. What is wrong with you?
I feel shamed. Now I'm going to go fuck this rosé.
Great.
I do feel like we're doing a little bit of a throwback. Like, I'm drinking rosé. You're drinking beer.
I know.
Fucking Dan isn't here.
I know.
It feels like classic gayish.
Well, it's going to feel even more classic because we have corrections recorded email or voicemail style from fucking Dan. Are you ready for this?
I'm ready for this.
Hey guys, it's fucking Dan. Since I was busy studying for midterms when you recorded this week, I'm sending my corrections for episode 160, Butt Plugs, the old-fashioned way. First off, the movie in which Sean William Scott had his prostate milked isn't part of the American Pie franchise at all, so it's not even Stifler. It's a 2000 film called Road Trip, and he played a character named E.L. Second, toxoplasmosis is a parasitic infection associated with undercooked contaminated meat and exposure to cat feces, such as when cleaning a litter box, and has nothing to do with the pussies you were talking about. Toxic shock syndrome is the result of toxins produced by Staphylococcus bacteria getting into the bloodstream through a cut. It is specifically associated with superabsorbent tampons, not any tampon, but super absorbent tampons. Though there have been cases associated with post-surgery wounds, nasal packing, burns, and skin infections.
Nose blasting?
The exact connection to why super absorbent tampons were causing this wasn't fully understood. Some people believe that the extended use of those tampons attracted bacteria. Others think that the tampons was causing scratches in the vagina. And there's some evidence that points to those tampons causing an increased production of the toxins that were produced by the bacteria. And it's now quite rare because they removed super absorbent tampons from the market. I searched. I could find no evidence of toxic shock occurring rectally or anally, nor any evidence that it could be caused by wearing a butt plug for a long time. Given the materials butt plugs are made of are smooth and non-porous, I highly doubt that it would have a similar reaction in the body to a super absorbent tampon.
Fuck you, Dan.
Thanks for the corrections, Dan. I'm bored.
I stand by that being Stifler. Like his name, he was going by his middle initials, EL, in that movie. It was still Stifler. Every role that person plays for the rest of time until they die, he's Stifler. Which is unfortunate. Like when you have your first character out of the gate be something so iconic, you're just fucked. I mean, look at the Star Trek cast.
Yeah, Picard.
Yeah,
I mean, it kind of worked for him. Like, that's the thing is, I'm sometimes like, oh, that sucks to be known by your first thing. Like Jennifer Aniston, like she's never going to be known by anything else. But then also, like,
other than Rachel,
yeah,
okay, great.
Wait,
I don't
what
know.
Did you think?
I don't. Wasn't she famous
other than her role in Cake?
Wasn't she famous before that?
But
Courtney Cox was.
I don't know, but that was what launched her into superstardom.
This is not.
Let's talk about Rachel. That needs to be the name of her podcast. Okay. Oh, you have 100 words. That's the next thing.
Ooh, is that the next thing?
Great. Yeah. Right.
Sure. Yeah. Why not?
Cool.
Are you ready for it?
Yeah.
Wait, but we say hello to the Patreon people after the news. Now, should we wait until after the news to do this?
No. If you get 100 words, I think you get prominent placement.
Okay. Great.
You get
right behind Dan talking about cat feces. Here we go.
That's our prime place.
Here we go. Hello, Fantabulous Omies. I think my Patreon tier provides that 100-word shout-out thingy, so here's mine below.
Yes.
Hope it's not too naff. I've just come out in my 40s, and I've never had sex, but I understand lust and desire, so the words speak to me. Cheers, Dean. Here we go.
I never thought to check. He said, like, I think my level gets it for me. I don't.
We should double check.
We should check when they say, or I don't know, or not, whatevs.
Our eyes met for a moment and you smiled. Finally, I looked up and saw you looking at me with tenderness. Don't be scared. The way you said this, softly, perfectly calm, pierced right through me. I nodded. That's all I could do. You smiled. Dissolving the tension. We sat there for a while, in our private silence, worlds shifting in me. A flash of heat traveled from my stomach to my cheeks, my thoughts like a jumbled ball of string. I felt like a small bird set loose, scared and exhilarated by the void before me.
Are we going to make out? What's happening?
I don't know.
Wow, I was wondering why you paused and took a deep breath. That was beautiful.
Yeah. Weird. I think I hate it. It's from, it's extracts from Swimming in the Dark, a novel by Tomasz Jadrowski.
Huh. Well, that's cool. Wow. Yeah. Someone used their 100 words to give us culture.
I know. It's God, weird. Bring on the dick jokes next time, people.
That was someone talking to a penis. It's like you zoom out and you've been whispering to a penis.
You would have said our eye meets. My eyes
my
met
eyes
your
meet your
eye.
Head to head. Thank you. We just ruined a very beautiful thing.
Good.
News?
Oh, sure. Yeah, the news. There's news. First ongoing story, of course. This week, Jussie Smollett has vowed to fight or die as he asserts his innocence in the fake hate crime case.
Damn.
The embattled former Empire actor appeared in court on Monday to deny fresh charges of disorderly conduct for allegedly staging a fake homophobic and racist attack on himself. On his way to court to plead not guilty, Smollett insisted, quote, the truth will free me. He said, the truth is the best defense, the truth, which they know nothing about. He added, quote, it is definitely frustrating, but you just gotta. It's fight or die at this point, right? I don't claim to be innocent. I am innocent. I don't claim to be innocent. I am innocent.
Wow.
The actor, who has long maintained his innocence, was released on a $20,000 bond ahead of a court appearance on March 18th. Apparently, his attorneys are going for a double jeopardy dismissal.
Like, they already did this?
Well, so because he posted bond the first time and then did not get that bond back, he's out $10,000. They're saying that he has then therefore been officially punished for that crime, and that to retry him would be double jeopardy.
But bond, paying bond is not a trial.
Prosecutors insist double jeopardy does not apply because Smollett was not originally prosecuted.
Yeah.
So
I agree.
I agree.
But I will say, I feel like I want to say this every time because it doesn't feel like it is with the popular opinion. Hmm. I have not seen anything that says, that confirms definitively he is guilty, other than people's statements, which I don't believe people's statements at face value.
Yep.
The police, or in this case, you know, I want to default. No, I don't want to. I default to believing people that surface hate crimes and violence against them, particularly people in marginalized communities, Black, gay. And I will keep believing him until I see evidence or proof to the contrary.
Innocent until proven guilty. Victim until proven a faker.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's get a bumper sticker that says that shit on
it. Yeah.
Yeah. hashtag him too. Okay. next.
Yeah.
You ready?
Yeah.
In Largo, Florida, this week on Saturday.
Man.
Directly right next door to the Quench Lounge, an LGBT bar, has opened a coffee shop called Conservative Grounds. It is a Donald Trump-themed coffee shop, complete with a replica Oval Office, a wall of guns, and a red button on the desk that, when you press it, says things in Trump's voice to you.
Oh, boy. Wake up! It's Donald Trump! Shit's getting real! Wake up!
Oh, God. The coffee shop's website states that it was made possible by a, quote, diverse group of investors from many different races with varying sexual orientations.
Okay.
Which is...
They found a Black gay dude and were like, can you give me $5 and then let's... Yeah.
Oh, God. On his YouTube channel, Gephardt, so the founders are... Their names are Cliff Gephardt and John Tatum. He has a YouTube channel that suggests that, no, he's not. He's not down with... Like, they're trying to paint this as, like, we're just conservative. We're not against anybody.
Yeah, yeah,
his YouTube channel would suggest otherwise. His YouTube channel says, quote, the Muslim way of life is okay with and actually supports pedophiles. In another video, he rants.
Okay, I've never heard that horrifying thing.
I mean, yeah, just connect any two things you want to if you hate.
It's any minority and pedophiles. Like, what? They're obsessed with pedophiles.
Yeah, Republicans and pedophiles.
Yeah.
In another video, he ranted, quote, we're not homophobes. We don't care what you do when you're in a bedroom behind closed doors. We don't give a damn who you put your junk with and whose junk touches other people's junk. We're just tired of you talking about it on the street. We don't need to see parades, and we don't need to see all this agenda, pro-gay, pro-trans, pro-LGBT. Heterosexuals don't go and have parades and talk about how we have sex in missionary style. When you keep forcing it down our throats, then we become more anti-LGBTQXYZ. Transgender is crazy. It's a sickness. You've got your own problems.
Okay.
Go deal with them. Don't force us to buy into your Halloween costume. He's just a fucking asshole.
I mean, it's funny how he's like, stop talking about it. We don't care. Also, all this transphobic stuff. It's like he's proving why we need to.
Yes. Yes. And it's so the fact that straight people don't realize how fucking in your face and down your throat their sexuality is all the time, every day.
Yeah.
Holding hands at the mall and goddamn TV shows and fucking billboards and like their sexuality is front and center. I think they genuinely don't see it or understand that that's the case.
That's what I was going to say. I don't think they see it because it's so just like I don't see whiteness. That sounded very much like I don't see race. That's not what I'm saying.
Kyle, I'm white.
I don't. Oh, my God. No way. I always thought you were a ghost. Well,
I'm almost transparent.
Same. Ever since, especially Seattle. I don't see like, oh, my God, everyone here is white except one Black person. Like, I don't, you know, I just don't see that because I'm privileged and don't think about race all the time. Yeah. I think in the same way, they don't think about how everything is for them and they're the ones, we don't want to make gay an issue.
Yep.
They were the ones that did it.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely.
Also, I think
dirtbags.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Jerk. I also think Donald Trump themed coffee shop is where they tell you the person behind you is going to pay for it. And then not only does that not happen, you have to pay double and you never get your coffee.
Well, a guy left a review on Yelp that said, quote, I'm a retired army sergeant. And they said, thank you for your service. Then went on to talk about how liberals are destroying the country. This was the staff, mind you. Mm-hmm. Don't go here. It's a MAGA circle jerk with crappy coffee. That is, unless you're a fan of fascism, then go ahead and drink some of the worst coffee. Oh, that's it.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Last. News the last.
Yeah.
So I've been watching Star Trek Picard.
Okay.
What?
No, this is news, sure.
Do you know who 7 of 9 is?
Because 7 was scared of 9? Wait, what was
7, 8, 9?
Because 7, 8, 9? No, I don't know.
Yeah, why was 6? Why was 5 scared of 6? No, why was 6 scared of 7? Because 7, 8, 9. Anyway, if you don't want anything spoiled about Star Trek Picard, then you should probably skip the next 60 to 90 seconds. Oh. 7 of 9 was the hot Borg lady with the big boobs that was on Star Trek Voyager.
Borg lady?
Hot Borg lady. Borg lady.
Oh, I said the hot Borg lady.
Yeah, no, that's Lana Del Rey.
I was trying to pull something, and that's perfect. Oh my God, you did it. You did it.
Thanks.
Okay.
Yeah, so she was brought on. Voyager had these, like, sort of lagging ratings, and so then all of a sudden this character with giant boobs shows
Del Rey,
up.
Sorry, I'm still on that. Sorry. Okay.
Great.
Borg.
Yeah. So for a long time, they never addressed her sexuality on Star Trek Voyager, at least not in a direct way. She did ask one of the dude characters to bang her, but that was painted in, like, a, like, just, like, scientific academic type of an interest in how copulation works, not that she actually like was into him or it. Anyway, then there's been lots of fan fiction over the years that like she and Catherine Janeway were banging, so that was the captain on that show. And
ooh, banging the captain, that's hot.
Yeah. But there's always been this sort of fandom about that character being a lesbian, and they've alluded to it multiple times. Well, put this at the beginning of this.
Okay.
If you don't want anything spoiled about Star Trek Picard, then you should probably skip the next 60 to 90 seconds.
Oh, can't you put it just right now?
Yeah, well,
okay. Have you spoiled anything yet?
I mean, I've already talked about the fact that they've alluded to her sexuality a whole bunch, and it was confirmed last week, because on last week's show, she tracks down her ex-lover and fucking kills her, and it's great.
Wait, why great?
It's just great. Like, it's all female power, like lesbians, like, you did me wrong and then you hurt my boy, and then like, even though the sex was great, I'm gonna fucking destroy you. And to just like, it was explosions and female empowerment, and it was queer content on national television,
like estrogen exploding on people's faces.
But anyway, so 7 of 9, the Borg lady from Star Trek Voyager and now Star Trek Picard, has been confirmed to be a pussy licker. So it makes me very, very happy.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That show and the recent Star Trek reboot or whatever.
Discovery.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They seem to be like soups. I mean, you said this in our sci-fi episode. Like, they've always been soups down, and they just keep taking on the new issues.
Yep. Exactly.
Cool.
Exactly. And then people keep hating it, because they do.
Yeah.
But the people that are upset about that need to realize that that's always been what they do.
Yeah. So you were just too young to understand, maybe? And
maybe. Or too oblivious. Yeah. People do have their heads up their own ass a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. It's called heading. It's like fisting, but with your head.
Yeah. That's it. That's the news.
I don't know if I really want to, but also don't want to talk about this. I don't know.
What?
Pete Buttigieg.
Oh, what about him?
We recorded the last episode. We recorded the intro before this thing happened, but then it came out after.
Mm-hmm.
Just because in the last episode you were like, this new Pete Buttigieg thing, and then it wasn't the most recent thing because we record before.
Yeah.
Time.
Yeah, time travel.
Yeah.
Should I turn on the time cave? It's been a while since that happened.
Do you even remember how to do it?
I think it's like this. There we go. Yeah, it's the time cape.
I'm Pete Buttigieg. I'm only the mayor. Nothing else is happening to me.
I'm probably gay, mostly.
Oh, no. That's what I want to talk about.
Okay. So what happened?
Well, it was that moment where he said, if I could take a pill, I would have.
Yeah, sure.
And I saw gay people particularly, like, all up in a rage about that comment.
Sure.
And I feel so strongly about it. This is, at this point, old news, but I just feel so strongly about it. It touches on a lot of things we talk about, that so many of us, I would venture to say most of us, wanted to not be gay. Later, I realized that's because society's fucked up and I wish society would change. But at the time, that manifested in the form of, I want to not be gay, so I don't have to deal with this shit. It sucks. Yep. It's horrible. I hate it. The fact that he said that, it just echoes what a lot of us think.
Yep.
However, that unfortunately feeds into this thing that everyone has about him not being gay enough. A little bit I understand when he didn't want to go to a place with a stripper pole. Like, I get why, but that comment in and of itself, I 100% defend him for saying that. He also went on to say, I'm glad I didn't because I met my wonderful husband, blah, 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 blah. People overanalyze his husband's facial reaction, Chastain's reaction. I, again, like, think that was a understandable, legitimate, cool reaction. I would have had the same. Mm-hmm. I just, I'm not making any political endorsement. I just fully support that statement and that thing. And that also feels like not what gay people in general are doing.
Yeah. I mean, I think he, like, your gayta supports your supposition. The fact that 85% of the world's population is in the closet.
Correction, 83.
Okay, whatever.
I'm sorry. Are you getting mad at me fucking for being pedantic?
No, fucking Dan. I guess Dan's not here, so it's like,
yeah, we can't
somebody's
got to
be a dick. But yeah, I mean, it's hard to be out of the closet. And, like, I think that the idea that gay people have always been out and gay and happy and had no reservations about their own sexuality and wouldn't take that pill if it existed, that's lying to yourself. That's bullshit.
That's insane.
Your bullshit is bullshit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. This is so old school episode. I love it. Yeah. I mean, I also think there's a way he could have said that would have been perfectly eloquent. Also, he was answering questions, though. He didn't write that wasn't a prepared speech. That was a response to. So, you know, fuck off.
Yeah, fuck off.
Speaking of fuck off, I want to thank our Patreon. No, that's horrible. That's worse. Fuck on. I want to thank our Patreon members, Just John.
Just John.
Just John.
Just Jack's brother.
I thought we were going to be able to leave it at Just John.
Okay.
No, it's Tyrell Ben.
That's a hot name.
I know. He can bend me over.
Tyrell me up.
You're funny today.
Thanks.
Did you take your medication or
I
not?
Did.
I can't tell which one is better for the podcast. And Dustin Wilser.
Oh, I know that bitch. He comes to Piano Pop-Up Bar with his husband.
Oh, yes. I know him too.
Yeah. He's the one that sings, not plays.
They're both amazingly talented and annoying in that way. And seem like cute and in love. It's really annoying.
Yeah. Thanks for your money.
Thank you to all our Patreon members. If you want bonus episodes content, if you want to check out the most recent bonus segment where Dan let two fans control the butt plug in his ass, then that's at patreon.com/gayishpodcast.
Very uncomfortable.
Very uncomfortable.
So should we talk about Dolly Parton?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Here we go.
We're doing it.
Do you have a favorite Dolly Parton quote? Do you have any Dolly Parton quote?
I literally only know. I think no, just the one you said.
It takes a lot of money to look this cheap.
Yeah,
I love that one so much.
That's they're minimal. Yeah, we'll get into this. They're minimal things I know about her. That is one, like that quote that you said.
Yeah,
I do know. Even though I don't know a specific quote, I do know she's very self-facing, funny. Will joke about things like her appearance and boobs and shit. So I do know that about her.
But yep.
I don't know any quotes.
Yep. But guess what else?
What?
We have a guest today.
Whom?
She's right over there. Don't pretend.
Well, I'm trying to. Mike, this is the charade we build around the episode.
Pay no attention to the mom behind the curtain.
Oh, well, that revealed it.
Yeah, my mom is here.
Your mom is here.
Yeah.
It's been approximately 17 years.
Yes.
Since 17 is always the number when I pull a random number. Anyway, since she has been on. So she's also sitting right there. So I'm so excited. Can't wait to. No, it'll be great. I don't know too much about Dolly Parton or.
I don't know if she does either. We're going to find out.
Well, all of us, your mom as a gay man, we'll see if she cares about Dolly Parton as well. Wait, is there anything else you want to say about her before we get into it? I said my thing, which is, what else?
What about Dolly Parton?
Yeah.
I think she's fantastic. And I have some stuff to say, but I'm going to wait until after the break to say it.
Yeah.
Great.
Ooh, this is like a cliffhanger.
Should we take a break?
Let's take a break.
Let's take a break. Oh, I wish I could sing a song.
Jolene, 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 Jolene. Don't you fuck my man.
Yep, great.
This is the part where Mike and Kyle take a break.
Are we ready?
Are we back?
Oh, we're back. We're back. I was legitimately asking you if you were back before. What?
Or did you want to do Patreon first?
Oh. Nah.
Okay. We're back.
We're back. We have our guest.
We're with my mother.
Hi.
Patricia C. Johnson. Hello.
I'm sorry. Is that Dolly Parton there? Oh,
that was the echo off her big mountains. Yeah.
It's been a while since we've talked to you.
I know. What's, you missed me, didn't you?
We did.
I know.
What's been going on?
Well,
Have you gone on any dates? Have you hung out with any
I almost had a date, though.
Oh.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
What happened?
The neighbor of some people I house sat for. He came out and was like, mow the lawn. Okay, hi, wavy, wavy.
Out of his house.
House, not- yeah. Yeah. Then he said, well, come over for a beer. And I said, okay. So I went over and had numerous beers. Okay, so we kissed. Oh, my gosh. Anyway, he's really cute, really young, Anyway, we exchanged
is he at least older than
phone
me?
Number seat.
Oh, boy.
This time.
Maybe, yeah.
This time?
Yeah.
Have you dated someone Mike's age?
I don't think so. No, but I was...
Wait.
Oh, Kyle. Anyway, we made a date for the next afternoon, but thank God I don't know if he was stoned when he asked me out or if he got stoned in between, but anyway, he'd completely forgotten about it.
Huh.
Mm.
He seems...
Red flag.
He seems gay.
He really does.
Not
you know
show
what?
Up.
Yeah. You know what? He really is very getting that dar. Yeah.
Huh.
So maybe Michael will...
Oh my God.
I mean, to be fair, Mom, I date people younger than you all the time.
Bitch.
I just
that you're dating bragger. That's pretty
well.
That's pretty guardy Lou of you.
Mike.
What? What?
Did you hear that?
Hey Kyle.
Hey Mike.
What?
Did you hear that?
What?
It's pretty guardy Lou of you.
I don't know what that is.
I know you don't.
Polari.
I handed.
Con guardy Lou.
Is this a? Is this a Dolly Parton song?
No.
I don't know what we're doing ever when your mom's here.
Okay. We don't either.
Yeah.
Just, okay. Okay.
You gotta lean in.
Do you want to? Do you want to do our Polari word of the week, Ma Johnson?
Sure.
Guardy Lou.
Guardy Lou is the Polari word.
Yeah. Polari. Word Guardy Lou is for look out.
Okay.
Look out.
That's it.
That's it.
Look out. Look
Guardy out. Lou, there's a 4 o'clock, there's a straight guy. I don't know.
Okay.
Watch out. Yeah. Guardy Lou. Okay.
Guardy Lou. Ah!
Straight man.
Yeah.
Hide.
Is it an exclamation?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
I was trying to think of the... Yeah, yeah.
Or it's your cousin's name.
What's that called when
Guardy
you
Lou.
Give someone a command? There's a grammar
An imperative?
Word. Imperative. Of course you know that. Yes, it is an imperative. Look out. I just thought that was a fun one.
Mm.
You're not... Yeah.
You thought right.
Thank you.
Good call, Kyle.
Yeah.
Guardy Lou.
Guardy Lou.
Guardy Lou.
Should we talk about the topic for this week's episode?
Sure. Let's talk about Dolly Parton.
Okay.
Boobies.
Yeah.
That's been gayish. Okay, I just assumed before we started recording, you maybe implied that you maybe don't know everything about Dolly Parton. I thought she I thought she would be like right up your alley.
Yeah, we have the same
best friends.
Ring size, I think, maybe.
I just see like she's country, she like
is Western. She's both like, kinds of music, country and Western.
she's also like ridiculous and she's a personality and she's really cool and down with the gays. Like she seems like everything that you are.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'm going to get some implants someday, too. Well, she admits, you know, she's had surgery and all that, but she's really great.
What's your experience?
But her husband is in the closet.
Is she currently married?
She's been married for 54 years.
Oh, wow. Wait, is this your supposition that he's in the closet?
No, it's just he is not a public person whatsoever.
Oh, you don't mean in the closet like gay. He's just who knows? Yeah.
Carl Dean is his name. Yeah. They got married in 1966.
Carl Dean. So, okay, then let me back up. Tell me about your experience, what you know about, think beep, about Dolly Parton.
Beep, beep, beep. Kyle's backing up.
I thought we were about to flatline, but that works too.
What do you want to know?
I don't know. Do you care about her?
She's great.
Do you
know her? Great talent, unbelievable songwriter.
She's written a lot of songs for a lot of people.
Yeah. She's just, you know what you're getting.
Yeah.
You know, you just know it's going to be really good, but, you know, bubbly.
Did you grow up listening to her, hearing her?
Yeah, I did.
Do you have a favorite Dolly Parton song?
No, but we became fond from Bessel the Horror House in Texas. A song that she wrote did.
Oh. When I was in high school, Mom managed a theater in Toppenish that was a dinner theater, and there was a group that came in and did the Bessel the Horror House in Texas, and I worked the box office. I worked the box. It was great. It was really great. It's also like one of those experiences where like... we probably saw that whole show like a thousand times.
Yeah. Mm. Hard Candy Christmas was the song from that was in that production.
Yeah, super good. Yeah.
Sorry, I was shaking.
You're fine. The table.
It was exciting, wasn't it?
It was fun while it lasted.
Yeah.
I don't know if we've talked about this. Like the reason I associate her or just any country with you and your family is your family has a strong connection to country. Yeah. Have you talked about that, Mike?
I'm not sure if I've talked about it on the show or not. My grandfather, so Mom's dad, wrote a song in 1973, 74, 72, the early 70s, before I was a thought.
Yes.
That did really well. Went like
number one in the nation.
And what was the song? Isn't it from the perspective of the truck?
Hello, I'm a truck. The singer of the song is an anthropomorphized semi-truck and talks about his...
Oh, semi. I always imagined it as a pickup truck. I didn't realize it was a semi-truck.
That's Mater.
Oh, my God. Grandpa came up with the idea for Cars before Disney did.
He did.
Fucking great.
Pay us. I mean, not us. I mean, you all, but...
Yeah, he still gets royalty checks, too, because it gets radio play sometimes.
Oh,
it's
nice.
Really funny.
Yeah. So I just, your family, just everyone is musicians, but also country. I, you know, just really associate that with you all.
Yeah, but there was also, that was the sort of period of in time when the woman in music, country music anyway, really came out. They were really strong in that genre. So there was Loretta Lynn and
Tammy Wynette.
Yeah. And her brother, Tommy, why not? Patsy Cline. And then she got dead early. That was really a big boo-boo in her career.
Really set her back a little bit. She's never recovered.
Yeah.
Just, oh, that's crazy.
She would be immortal. Well, maybe she is.
One of the reasons we're talking about this is because she is very much a gay icon.
Mm-hmm.
And in a way that I guess I get it, but I don't identify with it. I don't really care that much. She, I feel like, was a little bit before my time. Yeah.
I mean, isn't it true though that like in gay culture, it's the flashy strong woman that's going to get mm-hmm. that gives Cher. Zero fucks that is mm-hmm. going to get the icon status, right? Like
Cher.
Yes.
This is me, fuck everybody. I'm just going to be me.
Beyonce.
Yeah.
We respond to that or seem to as a culture.
This actually leads well into this is not what I was going to do first, but
and the gays put there's the, you know, the RuPaul mm-hmm. you know aspect of the fake boobies and the big crazy makeup and all like, that stuff.
Yeah,
and
she's almost drag queen-esque though she's a cis female.
Yeah.
I assume. I've never
researched. But I have a quick story about that.
Oh, okay.
If you want me to tell it.
Oh, in
part. So this is in the middle of an article I'm going to share the rest of later, but it fits in here really well. So, years ago, so 9 years ago on Good Morning America, Dolly was asked if it was true, and she confirmed, yes, it is true, that, quote, many years ago at a Halloween contest on Santa Monica Boulevard in West Hollywood, where all the guys were dressed up like me, I lost a Dolly Parton lookalike contest. she said, I went out there, I over-exaggerated my look and went in and just walked up on stage. I didn't win. I didn't even come in close, I don't think. But she lost a Dolly Parton lookalike contest at a drag bar in West Hollywood.
That's
fucking incredible.
Well.
Okay, that tells you so much about so many things, like about that area, about gays, about her, just everything. I love that so much.
Yep.
Have you seen, also side note, double tangent, have you seen that, or maybe you're the one that showed me this, the video of Jewel kind of going up in like a little bit of a disguise and doing karaoke to Jewel and everyone being like, oh my God, you're so good.
You like, sound just like her.
You sound like Jewel, but like people didn't realize.
Yeah.
That's what happens to me all the time. And then the paparazzi shows up and then fuck.
Everyone thinks you look like
Jewel. Yeah, I look like a bitch.
He looks like some bitch that's famous.
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
Or it's just the way you act.
Take it off.
Well, the thing I was going to talk about when we talk about gay icons, though, is this. Dolly Parton is very much something I associate with. You are a bad gay. People saying you are a bad gay if you don't know about or care about Dolly Parton.
Yeah.
That's another stereotype. Yep. Gayish.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, my God. That's the show. That's what we do.
Let's wrap it up. Drink. Everybody take a shot.
That, and we all do. And we all drink. What I want to touch on is that kind of idea. We've talked about this a little bit, that idea of you are a bad gay if...
Yeah.
You don't know who Britney Spears fucked.
Okay. What? Well.
K-Fed.
Yeah. Hello.
K-Fed. There is that thing like there, you know, name a influential pop female that someone particularly thinks is, if you don't know about her, then you're a bad person or you're a bad gay. And I wrote down, my queer experience is not the queer experience, which I think is what gay people need to remember.
Yeah.
Like Britney Spears, Kesha, there are certain people that are really important to me.
What's that one that got all the Grammys?
Lizzo?
Yeah, her.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to say to tell.
Yeah.
She's not that. Lizzo's very like a, will.
Balls not, out, kick your butt.
I bet Adele could lose a drag contest, Adele lookalike contest.
Oh, yeah. I bet. Because she has a distinctive look, but also someone more over the top would win that.
Billie Eilish, I bet she'd lose.
Oh, she would be a great, I don't know if she's any kind of queer, but she just reads queer. She feels queer.
It's because she's trying to be non- You know, like she wears big clothes. You can't tell her body shape, that she's wanting to be appreciated just for her talent.
You're like in the know, like bring up Billie Eilish.
I think she's awesome. I absolutely love her. Love her.
She started the whole like, I have green hair in my roots trend.
And your kind of fingernails. They look a lot like yours. Did you not see the Grammys?
No.
Good thing. You'd be 9-inch nails. Oh. I'm gonna go for the hairdo first.
Wait, does she have fingernail? You said,
oh my goodness, for the
like in what
they
way?
Were green and they're like long and all painty up. And she kept close, like there, she was posing with like, I don't know. It's like she was doing all these weirdo handy doodahs to show off her nails. And
There's... You look like you're doing a Home Shopping Network.
I am. Whoa, it's like Vanna.
But you're like Vanna who thinks she's voguing.
Yeah.
Whoa, whoa, like, whoa. But it's but look at my nails.
Yeah. Oh, look at these.
Boobs. Yeah, I feel like in an episode about Dolly Parton, we have to say the word boobs at least like 32 times.
And take a drink each time.
Take a drink. Oh, yeah. If you are playing at home and not sober. So I would just challenge people that use that phrase or think that you have to know about the thing you know about and care about. There are a lot of different people that are gay icons or important to gay people that might not be important to all gay people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So,
I mean, that works in multiple contexts too. I mean, fucking Christians need to learn the same thing. Your contexts. Your Christian experience is not the same Christian experience as everyone else. Yeah. Pete Buttigieg is a Christian. Fucking get over yourselves.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey,
sorry. I hijacked your thing.
No.
And he probably never danced to, "Oh, you single ladies. Oh, you single ladies. Oh, you single."
Seems
right?
Very true. I can't.
His husband did, but he didn't.
That's the truth. This is the truth. Well, that was one of my segments. I don't know.
Okay.
I have another thing that we could do now, too. Okay, I will do it.
I met a dog in San Diego.
That seems relevant.
Did you leave your heart there?
Was
that San Diego? I left my wine bottle.
There
was a bulldog
contest?
down by the bay, on the beach there, and he was pretty. I don't know, a bulldog. You know, picture this, and his name was Al Pacino.
Really?
Yeah, the bulldog. And so we knelt down and we went, "Attica, Attica." He didn't respond.
I don't know that. Why would you say that?
I don't get it either.
Scent of a woman. So Jodie Foster was in a movie, Taxi?
Taxi Driver, yeah.
And he was, anyway, that might not even be it. So there you go. Go look it up. Google it. Google that shit.
I'm lost in 12 different ways, yep. But okay. Well, okay. Speaking of animals named after famous people, mm-hmm. we mentioned Dolly the sheep is named after Dolly Parton. I learned that from listening to the first episode of Dolly Parton's podcast.
Yeah, which is a big deal.
Yeah, it was
lots
like
of people
huge.
Were listening to that show.
Like, mm-hmm. I don't, for being in podcasts, I know a lot about the industry, the numbers, the marketing, all that side, but I know a lot about gay podcasts because I'll just find them and listen to them or whatever. But, you know, it's not that I'm researching or know everything. I've never listened to the Joe Rogan Experience.
Howard Stern?
I actually have watched.
Oh, he's got some great acts on there. Incredible music.
Does he have a podcast?
Well, he has. You can see him, though, but
I love Howard Stern. His I've watched YouTube videos of his radio show, mostly when he's interviewing celebrities.
Yeah.
It's so good. He's something that made me love him particularly. He seems like a very straight dude thing. So the fact that I'm gay and love him is not a stereotype. What are we talking about this episode? I'll keep going. But what I like, he talked about this dude wants to see chicks' boobs, has strippers on, like was in that movie Raunchy Boys or whatever it was called.
Private Parts?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My God, Mike, you have to translate two people into English. I remember him talking about, I love buying like a new sweater and bringing it home and getting to wear it for the first time. Like he talked about this thing that as a dude's dude, that's a dumb phrase. I hate that I just said that. But like he talked about loving buying clothes and putting them on.
Mm-hmm.
He is so honest that it's sometimes correctly makes him look shitty, but like he's just super like celebrities that go on a show they have to be brutally honest,
like Trump. That was funny.
Oh wait, I couldn't tell if he was he on
Howard Stern? He's been on Howard Stern before.
Probably. I just meant he's so brutally honest all the time.
But Trump isn't brutally honest. That's the thing that's stupid, is he's not. Everything is a lie.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's not also not okay.
A stereotype.
Let's pull ourselves out of the 15 rabbit hole that we're in. So Dolly, named after Dolly.
Dolly the sheep was cloned in Scotland in 2000 something.
Is this just information you know?
Off the top of my head, I hope you should fact check all of this. Fucking Dan.
Oh, Dan, Dan, you're not here, so you have work to do.
And they named her Dolly, the first cloned sheep.
Yeah, and
had the similar hair thing.
It's indistinguishable.
Yeah.
Apparently, Dolly Parton adopted after the sheep was done with science. Like she adopted the sheep and took her to. So I learned this from listening to the podcast, Dolly Parton's America. I listened to the first episode. I'm probably not going to listen to the rest of it. It's WNYC, you know, like the NPR thing.
Oh, we were on there once.
We were on, but it's a we were on.
Shitty balls.
Is that the sheep?
It's an NPR.
Oh, well, okay. Oh, that's what we were doing before. I get it. Okay. But I probably won't listen to the other one. So, it's NPR. So, it's great storytelling. It puts her in context of the divisiveness of 2016. And she is a unifying force. I think it was in the very first episode, at the very beginning, they talk about how, like, other than Adele, she is one of the people that is not only very well rated for sentimentality of people like her, but also people don't dislike her. No one dislikes her. That's the up there with Adele of like people just everyone likes her across all demographics. So it's interesting. It's that podcast is a huge. I thought it was Dolly Parton doing a podcast. It's not. It's interviews with her and someone talking about her. So well done. Check it out. I'm probably not going to keep going, but they made it interesting enough that even if you don't care about her, it's still a good podcast.
That's cool.
Yeah,
I'll check it out.
Did you? Will you?
Yeah.
You will you?
Maybe together.
But you always say that like you never actually listen to things I tell you to listen to.
I do sometimes.
Do you? Mm-hmm. What's the last thing you actually did that I said to?
Gay Future.
You listened to that?
I listened to part of the first episode and then I had a phone call and I stopped.
Oh, not when I made you listen to some of it?
No.
Oh, you did it on your own?
After that episode.
Oh.
Yeah. I want to hear more. I've not prioritized it, but
Okay. I didn't know you did anything, I said.
I know. Because if I told you, just go to your head and then you'd use that power for
it's
bad.
It's too late. Yeah, it's already. You listened to half of a thing I told you to and it's already.
The dark side of Gayish.
Yeah, so my turn?
Sure.
Okay, you were looking expectantly at me like.
Well, I just didn't know what we were doing anymore.
Yeah. Okay, great. Yeah. Gayish. Okay. What, so I want to read through quickly, as quickly as we want. The Advocate had an article in 2018 called 8 Times Dolly Parton Cemented Her Status as an LGBTQ Icon.
Oh, yeah. Let's figure out for people like me.
So, number one, Dolly loves drag. And that's the story about her losing a drag lookalike competition about her.
Should I do my... Okay. Something I wrote down as things I know about her without doing any research.
Okay.
Should I say those and then I can actually learn why she is?
Yeah.
I'll do these quick.
Okay.
I just like sat down and was like, what do I know about her? Why do I think she's important? Okay. So here are the bullets. I'm pretty sure I spelled her name right.
Uh-huh.
That's number one. I did. I checked later. I wrote country, also musicals.
Okay.
Jolene, 9 to 5.
Mm-hmm.
About Jolene, some dude I was dating used one of my 10 Zune songs for the month and downloaded it. And I was really annoyed.
Okay. Great.
I knew the quote you said, it costs a lot to look this cheap. She appeared in Miss Congeniality 2.
Oh. Okay. Is it like you have encyclopedic knowledge of that particular
No,
film?
I just was watching that because it was on and
okay, great.
I don't know. Crazy Hair and Boobs,
mm-hmm.
Gay's Lover,
mm-hmm.
Songwriter. Before this is out of order, I wrote, has that podcast I haven't listened to, Dolly Parton Does America? It's called Dolly Parton's America. But and Soup's famous, but seems chill, funny, and self-effacing. That's what I knew of her.
And she has her own theme park called Dollywood.
I was there. I've been there.
Yeah?
Oh, really? How was it? What was it?
It was really fun.
What do you do there?
I just went...
Is it like roller coasters? Or like...
No. Well, some of that. Just a really in the Smoky Mountains. A park thing, and yeah, it was cool. I didn't get in any boobs though. I was kind of bummed when I left. They weren't in the gift shop.
Who were the clientele there? Was it like
country music fans?
It wasn't like obviously homosexual.
I don't know. I didn't poll anybody. They didn't have any polls for me to check out. So I have no idea. There isn't like a back room where people are looking at her.
There's that you knew about.
Yeah.
The best gay back rooms are ones the straights don't.
I want to get polled.
Hi, this
don't
is Gallup.
We all?
Oh my God. You should name, like, if you find someone named Gallup, poll me. Okay. Mike.
Great.
That's what I knew about Dolly Parton before.
Yep.
And now, well, I kind of learned more when I listen to her podcast, but teach me.
Here's some things. So this is specifically about being an LGBTQ icon.
Yeah, no, I'd love to.
The first was the drag thing. The second was that she knows the folly of anti-gay judgment. So she spoke lovingly of her queer fans in a 2014 interview with Billboard and added that those who criticize and judge LGBTQ people are committing their own kind of sin. Quote, Dollywood, about her theme park, is a place for entertainment, a place for all families, period. It's for all that. But as far as the Christians, if people want to pass judgment, they're already sinning. The sin of judging is just as bad as any other sin they might say somebody else is committing. I try to love everybody.
Hmm.
Number three, she showed support for LGBTQ families way back in 1991. She had a hit in 1991 on her album Eagle When She Flies that features the memorable song Family. And remember, take in context of the time, pretty progressive. The lyrics are, quote, some are preachers, some are gay, some are addicts, drunks, and strays, but not a one is turned away when it's family. Hmm. And the song is still performed in one of the reviews at Dollywood.
Hmm.
Number four, when things go wrong, Dolly makes them right. In 2011, a young woman at one of Dolly's Tennessee amusement parks was forced to turn her pro-marriage equality t-shirt inside out to avoid stirring the pot. She responded swiftly to the incident. Quote, I am truly sorry for the hurt or embarrassment regarding the gay and lesbian t-shirt incident at Dollywood's Splash Country recently. Everyone knows of my personal support of the gay and lesbian community. Dollywood is a family park and all families are welcome. I am looking further into the incident and hope and believe it was more policy than insensitivity. I am very sorry it happened at all.
Hmm. Cool.
Yeah, that's surprising. Yeah, she is so publicly supportive. I'm surprised anyone that would work there would think that would be reasonable. Yeah.
I mean, it's still Tennessee. Number five, Dolly supports women in power, including Hillary. She supported Hillary Clinton for president. She said, quote, Hillary might make as good a president as anybody ever has. I personally think a woman would do a great job. I think Hillary's very qualified, so if she gets it, I'll certainly be behind her.
That didn't work out.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Number six, the 2005 movie Transamerica, she wrote a song for that movie.
That was nominated for an Oscar.
That was nominated for an Oscar. And she had at least some part in that movie's success by supporting it and writing for it. Number seven, she is on record saying that trans bathroom bans are a bad idea. Quote, I think everybody should be treated with respect. I don't judge people and I try not to get too caught up in the controversy of things. I hope that everybody gets a chance to be who and what they are. I just know if I have to pee, I'm going to pee wherever it's got to be.
Okay.
I'm taking these cans in the can. If I can, going.
Ma Johnson, what's the weirdest place you've peed?
Oh, there's no weird place. Dolly just said there is no weird place to pee. Well, she didn't say that. But
what's the most unexpected place you've
peed? I think it's like kind of subjective, right? I mean, it's like
on your neighbor's doorstep.
Yeah. Set it on fire and stomped it. No, that's not what you do. So in horse trailers, in bushes, in actually we'd go hunting when I went hunting with your dad, and there was the pissing tree. This freeway got put in and there was one tree for miles, and you go back there to go to the bathroom and I mean it was like white with toilet paper. There's so many
pissing tree. That's a different children's book.
There we go.
It's the sequel to The Giving Tree.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, if I can
use this as an example. Straight people can pee anywhere, but trans people can't pee in the bathroom?
Yeah.
Like, right. What?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Anyway, okay, that was a
terrible.
The last one, number eight, and then the article is over.
Sure.
She stood up for marriage equality as early as 2009. She was on News Breakfast, a program of the Australian Broadcasting Corporation, and she was advocating her support for the LGBTQ community down under. They asked her, how do you feel about gay marriage? She said, quote, Well, why can't they be as miserable as us heterosexuals in their marriages? Yeah. Hey, I think love is love, and we have no control over that. I think people should be allowed to marry. I'm not God, you know. I believe in God. I think God is the judge. I don't judge or criticize, and I don't think we're supposed to. Hmm. So there's 8 reasons that Dolly's great.
Yeah. What I learned, again, I feel like I, yeah, listened to this one episode of the podcast, and I'm like, let me espouse, you know, like, I'm like one of those people that takes one, like, new age green CBD yoga class, and I'm like, you've never heard of it? Like, yeah.
Do you also claim expertise? That's the Dunning-Kruger effect in, right there. Like,
what? Oh, you know a little bit, and you're like, no, absolutely. I don't think I've ever claimed expertise over anything, and if I did, I was lying. She is an amazing songwriter. We touched on this. She's written over 3,000 songs. She's had amazing hits. She's won Grammys. She's been nominated for Golden Globes, Oscars, Emmys. Like, she is an incredible talent and doesn't get treated with the same respect. This is, again, like, I'm just stealing from the first episode. But, like, does not get treated with the same respect as male songwriters.
Yeah.
And I think that's something gays identify with, of, like, well, like, not getting the respect you deserve, like, the fact that she is female or has boobs or jokes about herself, self-effacing, like, a lot of those things get the kind of prominence in people's minds, instead of she's an amazing, amazingly talented person, amazing songwriter. She wrote I Will Always Love You, which Whitney Houston redid, which mm-hmm. became like that. I mean, it was already a hit, but then became that smash hit.
Soundtrack of The Bodyguard.
Smash hit doesn't even seem like enough to talk, like, you know, that how, like, big that song is, like,
still mm-hmm. like top 10 songs of all time.
Yeah, exactly. So she is an incredible talent, and I just hearing her talk, it was just so great to hear in this interview, and gave me more respect for her, in that she's just funny and open and honest. This is what you were saying at the beginning.
Yeah,
she's just who she is, and she jokes about herself, and she mm-hmm. is who she is, and she doesn't brag about all the shit she's done, but she's amazing.
Yep. Did you have more?
Nope.
Okay, I have one last thing, and I'm interested to see how it turns out.
Oh, okay.
Okay, here we go. Fair use and all that. That's the beginning of the song Jolene. And despite everything that I said earlier about taking what she says in context and remembering what time it was, mm-hmm. Jolene is an awful song.
What?
It's fucking terrible. I'm going to read the lyrics and we're going to talk about it.
Oh, I'm so interested.
Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. Mm-hmm. Jolene, 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 please don't take him just because you can. Your beauty is beyond compare, flaming locks of auburn hair, ivory skin and eyes of emerald green. Your smile is like a breath of spring. Your voice is soft like summer rain. I cannot compete with you, Jolene. Oh, but he talks about you in his sleep. There's nothing I can do to keep from crying when he calls your name, Jolene. Oh, and I can easily understand how you could easily take my man, but you don't know what he means to me, Jolene. Jolene, 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 I'm begging you, don't take my man, blah, blah, blah. You could have your choice of men, but I could never love again, because he's the only one for me, Jolene. I had to have this talk with you. My happiness depends on you, and whatever you decide you'll do, Jolene.
First
of all, I think that the message that women have about not holding the man culpable for what happens in a relationship is terrible. And I think a lot of gay culture has adopted that.
Yeah.
Jealousy is, I think, maladaptive. And I think that women think that other women can steal their man really limits their power. And I think it's a horrible message. And this song has become this iconic thing that sort of validates that that's even possible.
I was waiting for the bad part. Those parts are what you read from what you read?
Yes.
Interesting. I get what you're saying. I'm doing the therapy of, like, I validate your perspective.
Yeah.
And here we go.
Why are men great till they gotta be great?
That's perfect.
Don't text me.
Tell it straight to my face. This is another episode about. I think it's interesting. Like, to me, it reads as someone's jealousy of another person. It's almost not about the man. It's about I'm jealous of all these things you are, and I feel like I don't deserve this person I'm with. Please let me, like, it's almost like a lack of self-validation, a lack of recognizing your own worth and seeing other people and thinking that their looks, their accomplishments, whatever they are better than you, and not feeling good enough.
Do you suppose they did knock knees or no?
Like the man and Jolene?
Yeah.
I don't know.
This maybe could be just something she's observed, and she just is like fixated on how beautiful, and God, it'd just be easier and shit maybe, for you to.
Maybe Jolene is the other woman, and she kind of knows way. It, suspects it, but.
Yeah.
No. Well, and so according to the Wikipedia article, that song was inspired by real life events, that there was a redheaded bank clerk that would flirt with her husband.
She did tell that story.
And it was around the time that they were newly married. And I mean, that's where it comes from. But I just, why doesn't Carl get the blame? Like, why Jolene just wants to work at the bank with her cute hair? Like, what?
Yeah,
that's true.
I don't know why she's being pleaded with. Yeah. Like, it's like what's in your relationship is not anybody else's fault.
Yeah. I hear. I like stepping back from this song overall. I agree. Like, yeah, people tend to blame the person their partner cheated on them with or fucked up with, when it's like, this is, yeah, it's about you and your partner's relationship. Just because that person was there, did something like that,
despite everything that's happened, I don't hold any ill will toward who Trevor left me for. We knew them, we were friends with them, and like,
yeah, that is, well, that's a little bit different because, yeah, you were friends with them.
It would be easy to hate them, but I don't.
Yeah. Huh?
Because it's not on them.
Because I do hate him. It's them for him.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, yeah.
I'm a surrogate hater. If there's someone in your life that you would like to
5855 gay, mom will hate them for you.
You have someone. What will you? Will you? If you
I'll
call
kick
in someone
the
you
shit
hate,
out of them. Yeah.
Call in with the person you hate in their phone number, and Ma Johnson will yell
call
them
up and say, "Look, bitches, fuckers, don't mess with." Fill in the name.
Also, I might have come on a little strong with this song and my hatred of it because Jolene was my ex-wife's middle name. Because of that song. Wow. I'm not kidding.
That I'm glad you said that.
Oh, boy.
Now that's important.
The truth comes out.
I just think, I do think that as someone that I now know, again, I'm now, yes, I'm the, what is it, Doppler-Scheinman effect?
Yes.
Doppelganger banger.
Yes. What is the Doppler-Scheinman effect, Mom?
It is the giggly geik-kist-krist niner of lingo of a person adapting to a psychedelic
am I drunk or
ambiance? yes,
I,
some.
Yes, yes. Wait, what were we talking about? I now know. She is someone that writes very personal songs. She's written songs about abortion, about women getting pregnant before they should, men putting their wives in mental institutions because they
about
were just
fucking the same traveling salesman as her mom.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Mama got away with the traveling man.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
yeah.
Wow.
It's a great,
she's all over the place, I guess. But yeah, like it's writing from a
Coat of
experience.
Many Colors, you know, that was a song about her being teased at school. Her mom made they were so poor that she put together scraps of, and it was, she just loved it, thought it was the best thing ever, the coolest coat ever, because it had all these colors. Went to school and they absolutely just bullied her and hated her.
Wait,
everything.
Coat of Many Colors, Jeffrey and the Technicolor Dreamcoat?
No. Jesus Christ, Superstar.
Bobby McFerrin.
Yeah.
I don't know. We're just naming things now.
More wine.
Yeah. Where's my rosé? Oh, it's right there.
Sure. Did we do it? You now know everything about
Dolly. Wait, don't you want to know about my boobs?
No, sure, tell us. Let's get in there.
They're fabulous.
Oh, gosh, look at the time.
Oh, my God. Look at the wine.
Yeah, if you have any questions or anybody you want me to get the shit out of, call 555. You know me. .com. Who do they call? What's your
5855 Gayish.
Oh, I was going to say Ghostbusters.
58, sure. Yeah. Boob Busters.
We're ready to believe you.
Yeah.
I'm so.
The black one. Black one did do nothing.
I don't know what's happening. We need to stop whatever this is. Mike, please save us.
Okay, great.
It's up to you.
Should we take a break?
Your only hope. Let's take a break.
Let's take a break.
This is a place where Kyle gets us some wine.
Nailed it.
This is the part where Mike and Kyle take a break.
We're off track so much, but at the end, it just really took a nosedive.
Don't you think that's the charm way. Of
I think that's what I expected.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So are we back?
We're back.
We're back.
We're back.
I'm on my back again. Nobody's jumping off.
Oh, my God. Why does your mom say the gayer things than we do?
We are the champions, my friend.
We're going to do our gayest and
straightest. We're going to do our gayest and straightest, but first, our website.
Wait.
Oh, fuck. What?
I really enjoyed, Ma, something you said during the break, but I just want to say, oops, you spelled wine wrong. I just love that as a blanket statement for anything. Also, I don't know if we have enough like quotes that people find that are not sexual that we can use on stuff. And sometimes I just think we need to make our own and make them happen. Mm-hmm. Can I try to make oops, you spelled wine wrong a thing? Because I just love it.
Yeah.
I mean,
I can't speak for her. I assume she'll want a cut of some kind. But
no, yeah. You can get it.
Just say cunt.
She'll want at least one
cunt. What?
I just, I could picture someone telling me, oh, have you gotten a job yet? And me saying,
oops,
you spelled
wine wrong.
Anyway. Okay. Yeah, sure. We can do our contact info.
Our website is gayishpodcast.com.
All of our social media is at gayishpodcast. We're on Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter. Check out our Discord
National
server.
Geographic.
We're on National Geographic. We look really carefully.
Our hotline is?
BF549-ME.
It's 5855-GAYISH. It's 585-542-9474. Standard rates apply.
And our email is gmail@gayishpodcast.com.
And our mailing address is P.O. Box 19882, Seattle, Washington, 98109. The 4 R's. We haven't talked about the 4 R's in a while. It very, very, very much helps us out if you do one or more of the 4 R's. Rate, review, rubscribe, recommend.
Wreck them.
That's the 5 R's.
Once you've done one of the 4, then you can proceed to 5, which is rectum. It does. Everyone is awesome. People are so cool. And there are a million ways to support us if you like what we're doing that take, minutes. Mere moments, and we would really appreciate it. It means a lot.
Or I'm going to have to put up a Go Fuck Me page again.
Wait, people may want that. Wait, go do the opposite. If you review. But no, we don't say it enough how awesome our listeners are and just everyone that, regardless of what you do, I don't know.
Hey, Kyle.
Hey, Mike.
I don't want people to think that it's guaranteed or whatever, but... Remember that time just last night when we hung out with some listeners? We had drinks.
Yeah, it was really cool. We met up with some listeners that were in town from Portland. And
Jake Dettles rhymes with Bettles.
Do we say his name?
I don't know. We can ask him.
You can ask.
Jake Dettles and his husband, Josh.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really cool meeting up with them. They're
they're why I'm hungover today.
They're why you're hungover. They're also one of the, you start talking to them and you're like, oh, you're really smart. Yeah. But they're not annoying about it. They're, yeah.
Oops, yeah. You spelled wine wrong.
Oh, God.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Gayest.
Oh, wait.
Oh, bye. This Oops, is the Kyle Guest
spelled
Ahmad...
poop gone wrong. Oops.
This is the Ma Johnson and Kyle Getz show.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about what's our first episode of
our
You and I
episode
show going to be?
Reasons for awards.
Reasons for awards. Number one.
The biggest
ball.
Ball.
The
game.
Okay. They...
I don't know.
The second
elevator ride.
The third best
ribbon rider.
You win an award for the third best ribbon. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know why that's so funny to me.
It's redundant. Yeah. Or you got just under 10. You're just
inches?
Under a 10. What could be all those numbers under 10?
And oh, which
without
is
insulting
like
somebody. Pretty much you're every, just under a 10.
That's what, oh my God. I just had the idea of putting that on Grindr. How big's your dick?
Just
under
10.
Well, it's kind
of
true.
Yeah.
It is under 10.
There's a lot of numbers.
There's a
lot. You go into the negative numbers. Holy shit. We're going phenomenal.
You got to look inside my cave to find it. It's negative 1.
Don't talk about my cave like that in that tone of voice. You spelled wine wrong.
I don't know what just happened.
Oh, sorry.
Gone.
That's okay. You weren't a part of it. Okay. It wasn't for you, Mike.
It was always all about
it's
you.
It's not about you. It's about us.
Great. We got a letter in the mail, and I can't find it. So well, I'm going to read it next to
Thank
episode.
You.
I'll make up a letter.
Thank okay. you.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's
F.
Well, Gayest.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Gayest is straight.
Please let us.
The straightest thing about me this week is I did pop up piano bar. It's the last Wednesday of every month at the tasting room in Pike Place Market. And there was this girl that was in there, and she was a really good singer, and she like helped me out and did a bunch of songs. But
and she said like did not know this was happening and walked up and just was incredible.
Yep. And so
was it me?
And it was Ma, and here it loops back around. Yeah.
But the straightest thing about me this week, I think, is just the look on her face when I mentioned my ex-wife, because she was like, oh
honey.
And it could be the gayest thing about me this week, how crushed she looked when I talked about my ex-husband. But instead, the gayest thing about me this week, so I don't want to say his name, but a friend of ours was really upset the other night and came over and was like crying and having a hard time. And
me?
No.
Oh, it seems like something I would do.
Not this time.
But I'm not a friend, so it wasn't me.
But I got to like emotionally support him and hold on to him. And like, I don't think that that's something that straight guys allow themselves to do with each other. So just like to be emotionally available and vulnerable and physically touch somebody that's in pain. Like that feels very gay in an awesome, awesome way.
I will add that you've done that for me in a very sweet, like this. Wow. Really weird, vulnerable moment that like I didn't expect at this point in the
that time he held my hair back while so lovingly,
so tenderly.
Yes.
No, I mean it's just thank you,
straight guys.
Being,
too,
yeah, agreed. My straightest thing is I don't know if you've noticed this, Mike. I've started to call you bro a bunch. I don't know why. I just think it's funny, and
I've like refused to acknowledge.
I know. Oh no. Yeah. It's only been on Facebook Messenger, and you never say anything about it, which is totally fair. But I it was funny. I did that today, and was like, yeah.
Cool story, bro.
My gayest thing. I want to crowdsource.
Okay. Not crowdsurf, but crowdsource.
Oh, I would be too nervous to crowdsurf because, like,
I would
don't
like that.
Drop me. You would?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's get a Ma Johnson pile, and then she can jump. I enjoy painting my fingernails. I've now gotten to the point where I don't think about it as being like, oh no, I'm worried and what have you. And I want to find something that's like, what's the next step of a stereotypical femme identifying thing that I can
do? Your eyebrows.
Beard glitter, that's a
rude
thing.
No, I mean just like the blading or whatever they call it.
Oh yeah, yeah. Get like a threading. Mm-hmm. I just don't like, again, no judgment. I just like, me personally don't like super like manicured looking eyebrows. Mm. Anyway.
Okay, how about your balls?
Please thread my balls.
I don't know.
That's what I want to crowdsource. I don't know how many people make it to this far, especially in this episode, but if you have any ideas of like a next step thing that I can do, let me know. So my gayest thing is wanting to, like, what else kind of gay can I do? So yeah.
Awesome.
Ma?
The gayest thing I did last week was I got these really awesome red frame glasses are just so stylish and cute.
I really like them. They're
do you like them, Michael?
I like them too. Yeah. They're really great. You were saying that your hair gets stuck in them, and that kind of sucks. Yeah. But like,
it's a self imposed tear pull my hair thing because I can't get anybody else to do it for me.
But they're great. I like them a lot.
No, they're really like bold accent glasses are like feel very gay.
Yeah. Feel me. I feel gay anyway, right?
Ooh,
my
that's nice.
Straightest thing I did was I got a real pair, a other pair, like a more straight pair.
You got one that passes?
Yeah. And I only wear them in the closet.
That is the straight thing. Like, okay, I need to have something that passes at family reunion. You know, like, I need to find the thing that makes me okay.
No, but I'm fonder of these. The other ones are more like professional, like, you know. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's it.
That's it.
A special thank you to my mom, Patty Johnson. Thanks again for being on the show.
Thanks for being on. Sorry it's been so long. Everyone loves you and so glad that you
thank you.
Can be on and
I've been handing your cards out.
I know you have.
Wow.
I did one to the flight attendant today. He was so cute.
Oh.
Clearly
a homosexual.
Yes.
You could have just said a flight attendant.
Clearly a flight attendant.
Oh my God. Okay. Second new thing that I love is instead of saying he's clearly gay, like he was clearly a flight attendant. Okay.
You spelled one wrong.
A thank you to Dolly Parton for being amazing.
Yeah.
I decided my boobies are the unicorn horns of me.
And thank you to your boobs, then.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Oh, God. That's it.
That's it.
That's it.
That marks the end.
This has been Gayish. I'm Mike Johnson.
I'm Kyle Getz. Until next week, be butch fabulous to you.
See you next week.
See you next week.
Unless we got canceled.
Man. He's at a jerk off club today.
We do have our priorities in our club.